More on Sunday is brought to you in part by the 17 Northwestern banks in the Twin Cities area.
Good evening. Tonight on More on Sunday, the making of a wrestler. Last month, Chris Taylor made his professional wrestling debut. Tonight, we'll see what led up to it. How they took a 6'5", 450-pound collegiate wrestling champion and Olympic medal winner and turned him into pro wrestling's version of a human bulldozer. But first, this report from our health and welfare department. At the end of last week's program, we said that this week we would offer a special report on how one of Minnesota's biggest corporations may be endangering the lives of some of its customers. The next day, both 3M and General Mills called and asked if we were doing something on them. We're not, but since, we've sure been wondering what it is we don't know about them. What we had in mind was that Christmastime story from Schenectady, New York, about the elderly couple who died from the cold when the power company shut off their electricity. We're still wondering if it could happen here.
I cannot say it would never, ever happen. However, we are bending over backwards, going as far as we can to make certain that it doesn't. But you just can't say never.
When Al Austin did an editorial on the subject, Minnegasco told him that they simply will not shut off the gas in the winter. NSP said that it might, depending on the circumstances. Well, obviously, Minnegasco's policy is more reassuring. If it were true, it isn't. Both Minnegasco and NSP will shut off the power and heat in the winter, but the companies aren't going to cut you off because you're delinquent on a bill. NSP just started a new policy this winter. Now they say where heating service is involved and the temperature outside is 32 degrees or less and the bill is way overdue, they'll make personal contact with an adult living at the residence. They say they'll try to work out some payment schedule. And only if that fails will they shut off the power. The former policy was that they'd try to make a personal contact, but if they couldn't, they'd shut off the service. And there are cases where children in the house have watched the serviceman cut off the heat. That can still happen. The new policy is in effect only in the Twin Cities metro area, not in outlying areas or places such as St. Cloud. And NSP's former policy is essentially the way Minnegasco still operates. What happened in Schenectady could happen here. It isn't likely, but it wasn't likely to happen there either. The policy of the power company in Schenectady is really the same as NSP's former policy and Minnegasco's current one. Part of the problem is simply in the system. NSP and Minnegasco are, after all, profit-making companies, delivering a service that's a necessity that can mean life or death.
Our uncollected money from non-payment of bills this in 1973 totaled about $900,000. Is that too much? Is it just right? Is it not enough? And you can't answer it in dollars alone because you've got human needs out there. And I'm not sure I know what the answer is.
Two months ago, Chris Taylor had never fought in a professional wrestling match. Even so, while still in training, he signed the highest contract in the history of pro wrestling, $400,000 over the next 5 years. Considering his 450 pounds, that's about $55 an ounce, which makes him worth nearly half his weight in gold. What makes Chris Taylor worth so much, aside from his size, is his record as an amateur. He won the Big Eight title twice. He was national collegiate champion in 72 and 73. And he was a bronze medal winner in the 72 Olympics. In his 2 years at Iowa State, he won 87 matches without a loss, 70 of them by pins. It's Small wonder, then, that pro wrestling promoters are smacking their lips with anticipation. But it's a long way from an amateur match like this to this.
Oh! God!
This is professional wrestling at its finest, so to speak. Fighting in a main event like this one, with some of the biggest names and biceps in the business, is the goal of practically every pro wrestler. But more than half the battle is getting there.
It's one thing that I've never been much into doing is running. You know, Chris, when I feel like just saying forget it, you know, I'm all done. But there's something, I don't know, something in every athlete that I think that if you don't give 100%, when you go home at night, you don't feel right about it.
Okay. Now, hang on to it once. I'll be the referee. All right, but break before 5, you'll be disqualified.
Yeah.
Ready? Okay, you got a minute. All right, break, Chris. 1, 2, 3. All right, you got 5 counts, so a lot of these guys will hold you till right at the last second before they'll let you go. So by 5 counts, I'm telling you, you're pretty groggy. There. All right, Bob, you're back, all right? Did you line up pretty flat, right? Okay. Pick up Chris. Just go in there and see if you can do it.
Come on, Bob.
There you can. Okay, next, crouch. Okay. Get under him. Okay. All right, well, we know you can't lift him. Okay, let me try
next.
I'll just run.
No, shit.
No. Okay, here. Oh! No way. They're going to get you up. There aren't many guys. The Giant might be able to pick him up, right?
Right.
Donnelly or Jonathan might be able to pick him up.
Yeah.
Maybe if you ever wrestle against the material, which I doubt for quite some time, he might be able to pick you up, but men like that. But I know I, at 230 pounds, I can't pick you up. But it's a good question. How does it feel to be up there? I wouldn't worry about that too much, but there will be the time. It was a good question. What do I do if I ever get up there?
Great.
Panic. All right. All right, any questions right now? They're fresh in your mind.
I think 3 or 4 more days like this and I'll be ready to go.
Okay, fine. All right, you've got to be ready to go because Saturday's the date. You'll be ready. Okay. All right, that's it.
I was thinking, you know, just what in the world am I going to do or what am I doing here, you know? Just the idea that I had to go out against somebody that I've never seen wrestle before. I didn't know what in the world to do. I was worried. My mind was blank.
The more I talk, the more nervous he gets, so.
Okay, good luck, Christopher.
You can do it.
You'll do it.
If you walk out and they boo you, you know, you're the bad guy at time, that's it. I felt like they were... Okay. One thing I noticed that whenever I do something aggressive, where you pick a guy up, hold him up here, and then throw him down, the crowd would explode a bit. And this is something that really makes you feel good. You know, they're really for me. You know, you go out there and you do it again. You try to do things to please them. This is what it's all about. And this is what I try to do. Well, until you get into it, until you get involved and start getting thrown around and really being there where the punches are coming at you and where the blood's flying, if it happens to be, and things like that, you really don't realize. It's really a lot tougher than I thought it was. I mean, it's, as a matter of fact, it's brutal.
Going to make mistakes, he's going to be inhibited. A year from today, you'll see an entirely different Chris Taylor. And 3 years from today, it'll be a whole different ball game. He'll be a professional, he'll be a real seasoned pro.
We can't leave the subject of professional wrestling without recognizing that there has always been some rather serious doubts in the minds of many people concerning the sport's authenticity. Here now are two opposing views on the matter.
Is wrestling a fake? Are Shakespearean actors fake? Is Laurence Olivier really Hamlet? What are fakes, really? You? No, never. Wrestlers act and they work from a script. But the Vikings must have had a game plan in the Super Bowl, just like the game plan. The wrestler's script is changed and developed as the play proceeds. And there may be mistakes or moments of wonderful success. The last legitimate wrestling match, so-called, occurred between Frank Gotch and a fellow named Hackenschmidt in 1912. Most such matches ended with broken legs, as did that dull tug-and-haul affair lasting 2.5 hours. Legitimate wrestling was dull, like baseball or points after touchdowns in football. Audiences needed heat. Wrestlers gave it to them. Sure, wrestlers are actors, like all good athletes. Punters, spitball artists. But they act out an important morality play. Would you rather see the struggle between good and evil acted out in an arena or on the streets? I take the arena. So most wrestling is a fake, just as you fake when you wrestle in daily life with questions of good and evil.
You've got the audacity to ask me, is wrestling fake? Well, I'll tell you, it is not fake. The injuries sustained by wrestlers throughout the world, and when I say world, I mean the world, the countries throughout the world. There are more countries have a national sport of wrestling, whether it be professional or amateur, as you know, collegiate wrestling, than there are states in America. There are more people participate than any other one national sport in any country of any kind. This year, 3 men died in the ring that I know personally. You want to ask their families whether it's fake? As far as I'm concerned, the next person that asks me whether it's fake or not, I'm either going to punch right in the nose or I'm going to sue them for libel. That's how I feel about it, and I can prove everything I say. There are kings, Louis of France, Henry VIII wrestled, royalty wrestled. The biggest basket of wrestling matches throughout the world are such of the Shah of Persia and kings like in Kings of Nepal, the King of Nepal in Kathmandu, where I wrestled private matches for him. Crowds of over 150,000 people come to see it. I've seen 7 and 8-year-old Hungarian and Persian boys bang their ears on the wall to get a cauliflower ear just because they would like to become a wrestler. Yes, wrestling is a royal sport. It's the best sport. It's the most manly sport in the world. And anybody that doesn't want to believe it can come in the ring and work out with me or any of the other professional wrestlers. The people who ask that question are people who've never trained in their life and are despicable. If they want to ask a question like that, let them come and try first and then give an opinion.
Okay. For all you filmmakers out there, we'd like to announce the second annual More on Sunday Short Film Festival. So we will. Announcing the second annual More on Sunday Short Film Festival. This year, we're limiting the festival to 16mm film only. Last year, we had so many technical problems with the 8mm, we vowed we'd never do it again. But for the 16mm winners this year, we have cash prizes. $125 each for the four best films, $25 for the honorable mentions. Now, those who are interested in entering may obtain rules and application forms by writing to More on Sunday, Short Film Festival, WCCO Television, Minneapolis, St. Paul, 55402. The deadline for submitting films is April 19th. We'll be back in a minute. The last few years, television news has been taking a lot of flack from clusters of critics, partly, we think, because we've kept TV news such a big mystery. Well, next week we're going to show it all. What you'll see is a typical day in the life of the WCCO television news department, a taste of the madness of this strange business and the pressure of too much work in too little time.
It gives you ulcers. I've had one for 10 years, 12 years. I take my yearly sabbatical in the hospital and come back and go to work again.
TV news is a strange mix of show business, journalism, and Keystone Cops. Somehow, we have to find out what's most important in the world and wedge it into a half hour or a 50-minute newscast. Do it in a way you'll think is interesting enough to watch. We call next week's program The Scene Machine, and we'll watch it clanking and banging and wheezing out a typical scene at six. I'm Dave Moore.
Sunday has been brought to you in part by the 17 Northwestern banks in the Twin Cities area.